Next talk is by Professor K.R. Ravi.
At the outset, I would like to thank Dr. Baldevaraj inviting me here for share my experience in this one. I am coming from PhD Institute of Advanced Studies. It's a incubation and innovation center. So our group mainly works on nanotechnology for a different kind of application. So what I am going to present here is for how we are using this nanotechnology for societal application. So our group actually works on like different healthcare products, textiles, energy, and all different kind of aspects. Start from sensors for breath analysis, aquamarine, and food packaging industry. Textile we have used on dyeing and pigmenting. Water purification is one of the major thrust area that we are working on. So effluent treatment, some of the area that we are working on. So today I'm going to concentrate on is here is actually two topic. One is we are working on a self-cleaning coating for a solar panel application. That's I'm directly involved in that particular work. The second one is a dye degradation studies using biodegradable materials. So this picture is a very interesting one. Actually, this is a solar installation in Morocco. It is one of the largest solar installation in the world. If you look at this particular portion, there is a solar panel actually is placed and it is connected with a very near to a very big reservoir, a dam. So the problem is it actually gets energy, means we acquire energy like solar energy. The issue is the dust accumulation on the solar panel is one of the major issues. Maintaining the solar panel is a major issue. So what they found out is the water reservoir, such a big water reservoir is not sufficient to clean the solar panel regularly. So that is actually one of the major issues. So that's not very sustainable energy that I was talking about. Though we get energy, that's at cost of what? So it is not only the global problem. Actually, I had a chance to visit recently to the National Center for Photovoltaic in IIT Bombay. Actually, they were having like a climatic condition and maintenance of the solar panel is it's one of the area that we are focusing on. They get panel from different area of India and actually continuously check the monitor that quality of the panel and continuously check the efficiency. If you look at the panel, actually the top one is the bottom one, the top one, both are panels. In the bottom one, every day they clean it with the water. The top one, though it doesn't look like a panel, that is also a solar panel which is kept in the open environment for 1 month without cleaning with any water. So similarly, that the bottom one is also there are two panels. The top one is not cleaned with the water and the bottom one is cleaned every day with the water. That says that though we get energy, but the problem is like cleaning itself is a very, very difficult job. How do we clean it? If you have acres and acres of like such a big solar panel installation, manpower is not difficult. It's not easy. Like every day going there and cleaning is also not easy. Even a robotic also, it's many times it can break the panels. How do we clean those kind of solar panels? That is actually one of the major challenge. It is not only a global problem. In India, we have a different region and different locations. The kind of accumulation of dust, the kind of cleaning procedure required to be adapted are very, very complicated. That is why now we are working on one way of looking at this problem is there are two ways of solving this self-cleaning kind of a coating. One is based on a super hydrophobic coating where you make a non-contact surfaces so that that is going to dust doesn't attach. If at all dust attach also, the basic concept is any panel you kept it in an environment, there is going to be a daytime there will be a sun, you'll get a power from the sun, and at night there is a possibility of having a condensation of water. That water should be sufficient enough to clean the panel. If at all, maybe required a very small level of cleaning. That is the concept that actually we tried on this particular one, creating a super hydrophobic. Another one is a super hydrophilic also is possible, but again you need lot of water. So what we have done is we have taken a super hydrophobic surfaces, but the question is unlike just creating a super hydrophobic surface is not going to work here. So you have to have a solar panel without dust disturbing the efficiency. That means you should have a complete transparency. Nowadays with most of the panels comes with the anti-reflective coating. That means you should not disturb the anti-reflective nature, and again you should need to have a self-cleaning Not only that, I will come to the next slide, but at least I can say that actually what we could achieve so far is we could get a self cleaning. Again, if you look at this is a it looks similar and it is showing the anti-reflection nature. Now you can see the video that this is an uncoated glass. How does it works? If you look at put a drop of water and you can see that this is an uncoated one. Now you see this is a coated one. So very little water, it can easily take off all the dust particle. Can see now. So it's transparent, it is self-cleaning, but again we check the solar panel efficiency also, we could recover almost 92% of recovery. That means if we keep a panel in a normal environment, within a month, what we found out from the study from IIT Bombay, they said 70-80% of efficiency they are losing. That means you start with the 20% of efficiency, you will end up in a month with a 4% of efficiency. What we could see is with our coating, it at least we could recover around 90 to 90% of thing that we could recover. But all the thing that we have so far we did is on the very small scale level. Actually, our next step is we have achieved so far this transparency and the self cleaning. But again, the process scalability. But though the procedure what we are adapting is scalable, but then we have certain difficulties in going for a largest panel. Actually, now we are working with the ONGC Energy Trust Center to have a coating on a 1 meter by 1 meter level. Another one is the major issue is the durability. How do we say that? Actually, the question is how do we say that these coatings are going to last till the panel life? The panel life, the claim it's around 25 years. When I discussed with the professor in IIT Bombay, they said this, even they do not know that whether it can last 25 years, but they say it may be around 4 to 5 years, but we do not know what is the kind of durability that we are going to get on our coating. That is what actually we have. How do we devise a procedure to get an idea of the durability of the coating? This is where now we are working on. So there is another area that we have worked on is an effluent treatment. So if you look at industry, say the, what I said is our industry, our institute is work on, like basically it's a business to research to business. We work closely with the industries in and around Coimbatore. So we know that in nearby Coimbatore, Tirupur is in a textile dye industry. You have so much of effluent actually disposed on the in the rivers and other places. So the problem is, how do we actually give a treatment? How do we recover all those things? But again, there are so many other methods. People have said that methods are there, but none of them are, like, again, disposing those effluent treated material is also another problem that some of them have discussed. Like, if you need to have a biodegradable material, that is why we were working on some kind of a material to work on a biodegradable magnesium alloy. We were actually partially successful, and to have an improvement in corrosion resistance, actually we worked on certain magnesium zinc based calcium metallic glasses, which have shown a promising corrosion resistance. Unfortunately, it was brittle. What we found out is that same material actually we can use it for a effluent treatment. Those brittle material actually we could do on a ball milling process, and actually it can degrade dye. We tried with the Congo red, and we tried with the several dyes. It actually works well, and now we are working on a process like have a normal textile dyes which has a consortium of combination of all these dyes. That is what we are working on. So yesterday we had a talk on the TIFAC core. Actually, as Sanjay Singh pointed out, PhD Tech TIFAC core is one of the very well served and well organized, and actually is a well working TIFAC core center. Actually, this was started in 1998, and it was mainly for a product design based on a rapid prototyping technology. So the way that we work on is based on like this. Actually serves several SME, MME around Coimbatore, not only around Coimbatore, so all over India. Like we get lot of kind of customers from defense, ISRO and all kind of thing. The basic way that we work on is basically voice of the customer, marketing, R&D and such. But we do for a different kind of engineering and the thing. What I am going to talk about is like how we actually did for an kind of a medical application. So actually it was, if it was done now, it is nothing great, and it was done in 2005. Actually it was an person had a cranial temporary cranial defect, and we supposed he has a skull, a part of the skull actually has a damage. So what we did is actually we had taken the CT scan images of that particular one, and using the ABS plastic, that particular portion actually we made, that's not actually a biocompatible then. ABS plastic, using ABS plastic, we made that particular portion. Then again, that is a replica we made. From that, we made a PMMA. Using that, we made a surgery, and we could see that. You can see that actually that implantation, actually you can see that it is completely fitted into the human thing. So this is the kind of work actually that particular center do lot of things nowadays with the bone graft and skull, craniofacial, maxillofacial. But nowadays with additive metal additive manufacturing, now we have to look for a newer technology. Like in fact, even you can implant a titanium implants using this particular technology. That's where we have required a metal additive manufacturing technology. With this, I'll conclude my talk. Thank you.